He migrated, and we agreed that anyone who comes to see a Muslim, we should send him back. The Prophet kept quiet. This time, it was a woman. She sent her back. Since they wanted to harm her because she's weak. Then the holy verses were revealed by Allah Most High. All you who have believed, when the believing women come to you as immigrants, examine them. Allah is most knowing as to their faith, and if you know them to be believers, then do not return them to the disbelievers. They are not lawful for them, nor are they lawful for them. The verses were revealed to forbid sending back the Muslim woman to the Far East. The Prophet, peace be upon him, called her brothers, and he said, the treaty and agreement was between us men. The women have nothing to do with the treaty. We did not agree to send back the woman. So, the treaty was with the exception of women, and Umm Kulthum bint Aqba stayed with the Prophet, peace be upon him, in Medina, and after that, any woman who wanted to migrate would come to Medina, whether from Mecca or from other Arab tribes, since women knew that they were accepted from this condition. During this year, which was the sixth year, as we said, Fatima Zahra was born, daughter of Umm Kulthum. Of course, Fatima had given birth to Al-Hassan al-Hussein, and she gave birth to a boy named Mohsen, but he passed away, and also she gave birth to Umm Kulthum and Zainab. Zainab passed away, and Umm Kulthum made it through, and later was married to Umar bin al-Khattab. He asked her father Ali bin Abi Talib to get engaged to her. Ali apologized, saying she was young, but Umar insisted, saying, O cousin of Allah's messenger, I'd like to be of relation to the Prophet, peace be upon him, so let me marry her, Ali. Then Ali married her to Umar bin al-Khattab. Immediately after the Hudaybiyah Treaty, the Prophet, peace be upon him, sent Amr ibn Umayyah al-Tamri to Abyssinia in order to bring back those who had migrated there. You know there were those who migrated in the first year. In the fifth year, a number of Muslims also migrated from Mecca to Abyssinia out of fear of being tortured by the polytheists. They stayed in the lands of Najashi Ashama, who had been a Christian but was just and upholding to his faith. And that is why he gave the Muslims shelter and supported and aided them. Of those immigrants was Yumla Habiba bint Abu Sufyan. Her husband was Ubaydullah bin Jahsh. But while in Abyssinia, Ubaydullah renounced Islam and he died there in Abyssinia. Habiba was left there alone. Of course, Habiba was Abu Sufyan's daughter, the leader of polytheism and torture, the one holding the banner of torture against the Muslims. How could she go back there? How could she go there? The Prophet, peace be upon him, wanted to comfort her and give her pride after the hard times she had been through in Abyssinia, away from her people. Her father, the leader of polytheism and torture, her husband had passed away having renounced Islam, and he passed away there in Abyssinia. So the Prophet sent someone to engage Umm Habiba for him. He wanted to raise her status and make her one of the mothers of the believers. And Najashi was the one in charge of the marriage contract, and he was the one to pay the dowry for Umm Habiba. He paid her 400 gold dinars, and she was the only one who received such an amount after Khadija, may God be pleased with her. When the news reached Abu Sufyan that the Prophet, peace be upon him, married his daughter, Ramla Umm Habiba, he was very happy. Even though he was his enemy, and it was such a great lineage, and he said the stallion's nose would always be raised, meaning it was an honor for his daughter to marry someone like Muhammad, even though he didn't believe in him as a prophet. Yet, he recognized the honor and authority which the Prophet had. After the first conquest, after the Hudaybiyah Treaty, people were able to feel safe among each other. They stopped fearing each other. People started visiting each other. Those in Mecca would visit those in Medina. Meccans started to visit their relatives whom had migrated. Many people migrated from Mecca to Medina, and they had done so while in a state of conflict. They were in disagreement with their families. Now came a time when they could visit each other, talk to each other, have discussions, arguments, and have polytheists, right? Of course they were polytheists, and the biggest proof of this was Asma bint Abu Bakr's mother. Her mother, Qatila, came to visit her. Of course, she had been divorced before Islam. Mom Asma, that is Abu Bakr's wife, she came to visit her daughter in Medina. She brought gifts with her and many things from Mecca, and when she arrived at Asma's place, Asma didn't open the door for her. That's why. She was a polytheist and this scared her. She thought she should ask the Prophet, peace be upon him, maybe it's forbidden. And when she asked the Prophet, he said, you should receive her. And the holy verse was revealed. Allah does not forbid you from those who do not fight you because of religion and do not expel you from your homes, from something they had always worked for. They were ready for war. They didn't want peace nor security. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, got an army of the Muslims ready in order to take care of their only enemy at the time, and he set out to Khaybar along with 1,600 fighters of the Muslims. I always like to stress on the woman's role. What was the woman's role in the army setting out to Khaybar? The women gathered around the Prophet, peace be upon him, saying they wanted to go with him to this battle. Sinan al-Aslamiyya came to the Prophet, "O Messenger of Allah, I wish to set out with you on this mission you're going to." He said, "O Sinan, Allah has not obligated women to fight." She said, "Yes, I know that, but if I'm with you, I can feed the men, give water to the wounded, and treat the injured if there were to be any, and hopefully not. Hopefully there won't be any injured, but in such a case, then I'm willing to treat those injured." He said, "With Allah's blessings, then you can come. Your friends have asked me this, so go with Salama." So they all set out with Salama for the battle. Share of the booty. He gave her a full share.
she was killed after Bishop died. They killed her because she killed Bishop. Allah knows best as to which narrations are more valid. But I'm interested in the Prophet, peace be upon him's position. Even though that woman put poison in his food to kill him, the Prophet, peace be upon him, met her with kindness and a warm spirit and judged her based on what she said only. This is why in Islamic law we always base judgment on people's statements. How are we to know what's inside people? How would I know? I can only judge what I see. All rulings are based on this. As for the heart, it's judged by the Lord of Hearts, Most High. As for Sophia, after her husband Kinana passed away, and after the Prophet, peace be upon him, was victorious, all the women and all the money became a booty for the Muslims. This was the first booty for the Muslims after the Hudaybiyah Treaty. That is why, this time, the Muslims understood the meaning of Allah has promised you much booty. When this verse of the Fatah chapter was revealed, Allah has promised you much booty that you will take and has hastened for you this, meaning the booty from the Hudaybiyah Treaty, since they made a treaty with the polytheists and the war was over, and has hastened for you this and will help the hands of people from you, whom were in the Hudaybiyah Treaty. Allah saved them and didn't allow for war to take place. That it may be a sign for the believers, and that He may guide you to a straight path, and He promises other victories that you were so far unable to realize, which Allah has already encompassed, and ever is Allah over all things competent. Other victories refers to Khaybar, which the Muslims had won through the strength of Allah Most High and His aid and support for the Muslims. After the Khaybar battle was over, all the women, children, slaves, and money fell in the hands of the Prophet, peace be upon him. Of the women, slaves, and servants was Safiya bint Huyay bin al-Akhtab. You remember Huyay bin al-Akhtab, the chief of Bani al-Nadir, Jewish tribe. Ever since Muhammad became a prophet, peace be upon him, in Mecca, he was in Medina, sending messages to the polytheists of Quraysh to incite them against the Prophet, peace be upon him. Now his daughter fell into the hands of the Prophet. Imagine if the conqueror was someone other than the Prophet. What would he have done to the daughter of his enemy? He might use her to avenge himself. made out of dates and raisins. She was a happy bride, and she got up to serve the people herself. Once she arrived to Medina, she had lots of gold, since she was rich as the daughter of the chief of the Jews, and she had lots of money. She gave the gold as gifts to Fatima and other women of the Ansar, so there would be some kind of friendship between them. The seventh year came along after the migration of the Prophet, peace be upon him. During this year, there was safety and security, and the immigrants to Abyssinia returned. The immigrants to Abyssinia, whom had been with Jafar bin Abi Talib, Asma bin Tumais, and there were six women who returned with Asma bin Tumais from their journey to Abyssinia, after spending 12 years in Abyssinia. And their arrival coincided with the return of the Prophet, peace be upon him, from Khaybar, and the Prophet was very happy. He hugged Jafar bin Abi Talib and said, "I don't know for which I should be more happy, the conquest of Khaybar or the return of Jafar." The Prophet, peace be upon him, and Jafar returned to Medina, and the Prophet began sending letters to kings. He sent letters to Kisra, and also to Al-Muqawqis, the ruler of Egypt, and to Al-Najashi and Hercules, letters through which he invited them to Islam. The replies of these kings differed, but the notable one was that of Al-Muqawqis, for he sent a gift to the Prophet, peace be upon him, Maria and Serene, meaning he sent him two slaves. He also sent him a doctor and lots of gifts. The Prophet, peace be upon him, received the two slave girls, Maria and Serene, and he let them stay at Umm Sulaym's house as guests, and the Prophet, peace be upon him, went to them and talked to them about Islam until they both embraced the faith. The Prophet married Maria and married Serene to his son, bin Thabit. With that, we end our episode for today, since the time is over. But before we bid you farewell, we will take questions after the break. Professor, you told us how Maria and Serene were given from one man to another. You surprised how the two slave girls were given from one man to another. They were called a mat. They were owned by one man, and they were given to another man. That's right, but if we were to think of it according to our laws and reality, we'd find it very strange. But I told you many times, we shouldn't match our laws and traditions with their laws and traditions.